Praise God. Praise God. Let the people of God say amen. Amen. I welcome you to The Bread Broadcast, a weekly Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we edify, we exalt, and we challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to be talking about the three W's to live by. The three W's to live by. And our case study is going to be Saul of Tarsus, who later became Apostle Paul. So it's going to be Saul of Tarsus, that's his name, before he became converted. And after he became converted, he became the apostle to the Gentiles, and we know him as Apostle Paul. And your short reading, yes, is Numbers chapter 27, verse 12 to 23. Numbers chapter 27, verse 12 to 23. But before we go, let us pray. Father, we thank you. Dear Jesus, we love you. Sweet, blessed Holy Spirit, we honor you. Hallowed be your name. Thank you for bringing us here again. Holy Spirit, you are the Spirit of truth. And Jesus said, you will teach us all things. We pray that you will do your ministry of teaching through this lesson. Take all the glory. Give us the blessings. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Our foundation text is Acts chapter 17. We are going to read verse 28a. Acts 17:28a. For in him, in who, in Jesus, we live and move and have our being. Now, the three W's they're like an onion. It's like an onion. Each has its own layer, but they cannot be separated. No. So what are the three W's to live by? Number one, God's word. This is the proclamation of God to you, to me, and through you, and through me. This is where and how you get the message you are to live by and pass on to others in your place of assignment. For example, if God has called you to the marketplace, you work as a banker, you work as a nurse, you work as a plumber, a technician of any kind, hairstylist, plasterer, whatever workplace God has called you to, God has a message for you and through you that you will be giving to people that you meet in your workplace. And if God has called your workplace into the family, you are a stay-at-home mom. God said, the assignment I have for you is to train those children up. And I've seen many, I've worked really with some women who studied as engineers, and they left their engineering jobs to look after their children, you see. So don't think, oh, it's a failure for me to go to college and be a homemaker. No, your job is as divine as somebody who dresses up in the morning and goes to the hospital as a medical doctor, okay? So if God has called you into the family, if that's where your workplace is, God has a message for you and through you. The Word of God, the Bible, that's what I'm talking about, shapes you how you respond to life's situations. and how you respond to others. It is a way of life by which you are generally known to live by others. Saul of Tarsus, watch this, only had the language of religious violence to jail, to maim, and slay early Christians. But after his conversion, his language changed, you see, to that which preached the gospel to sinners, encouraged and edified believers everywhere he went. Peter and John had a similar experience too. After their 3.5 years of training under Jesus, they became God's mouthpiece. Watch this. When our life is immersed in God's word, the Bible, it goes beyond mere vocalization of words. It affects every area of your life. Your demeanor, your behavior, the way you act. I mean, the word of God soaks you up if you dwell in the word of God. So it goes beyond just what you say. The totality of a discussion is shaped by God's word. That's why it's very easy to know a carnal Christian. Oh yeah, very easy. Somebody tells you, I'm a Christian. Oh yeah, I sing, I'm a pastor in my church. Just stay up, hang around them for some time. You will know. You will know, you see. The word of God forms the backbone of a conversation. Let's go to the book of Acts, chapter 4, verse 13. Acts 4:13. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, who were those? The Pharisees, you see. When they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men. In other words, they were uneducated. They've never been to school. The Pharisees marveled. They were surprised. And they took knowledge of them, watch this, that they had been with Jesus, you see. In the time of Peter and John, there was no New Testament for them to read. They had Jesus. That's more than any other book you can read, you see. So they trained under Jesus. They were constantly with Jesus. And the Pharisees had not even listened to what they had to say. But the boldness, just the boldness, they knew these ones are not shaking their boots. What's going on? Then they perceive they've been with Jesus. That's what the word of God will do to you. This is Jesus, okay? The word of God. Constant personal interaction with God develops personal acclimation with God. Constant personal interaction with God develops personal acclimation with God. Moving on. The second W that you need to live by is God's will. This is God's plan for you and for me. It is what God wants us to do for him. Saul of Tarsus was a religious fanatic. He was the Osama bin Laden of his time, you see. However, God's will for Paul's life as an apostle of the gospel was to be a missionary who will spread Christianity. Guess what? After Saul of Tarsus became a Christian and is now called Apostle Paul, guess who brought the gospel to Europe? Apostle Paul, the modern day Europe. He went to Greece, he went to Rome, you see. And Macedonia too, it's part of Europe. So God had a different plan for Saul of Tarsus. God created, please listen carefully. It doesn't matter if you're a Christian, a Mohammedan, a Buddhist, listen, please. God created everyone with a divine purpose in mind. No exceptions. God had something for every one of us to do before he created us, you see. Did God create Adolf Hitler? You bet he did. But did he create him to come and exterminate the Jews? No. Adolf Hitler became who he became by his own freedom of choice, freedom to do what he liked, that God will never mess with as a human being, you see. God has given human beings to choose the free will he has given us, and he will never mess with that. So by Adolf Hitler's free will, he became Adolf Hitler. The same with Osama bin Laden, you see, and all of that, whatever historical bad images or figures you can think of, you see. God had a divine purpose in mind before he created every one of us. But when people get here, then they begin to choose who they want to be, you see. Only a handful of people live to do the very work for which they were created by God. And it's a tragedy. And the reason for this tragedy has nothing to do with God. No. An unbeliever, listen up. If you're a pagan and you're saying you don't believe in Jesus, listen up. This will help you. You need it. An unbeliever gropes around in life, that's you. If you don't believe in Jesus, or you are yet to accept Jesus into your life, you are groping around in life. You can't find your way. Oh no, you are lost. But that can change. You are trying to find yourself, you see, because of your failure to surrender your heart to Jesus. Jesus says, I am the way. You see, it's hard for you to walk through a thick jungle and say, oh, it's beautiful. No. When you walk on a footpath, it's different. Jesus is the way. But you don't want to have anything to do with Jesus. So you've been running around like a headless rooster in the jungle of life. But that can change. A genuine child of God may equally miss out on God's will because of outright disobedience, you see, or sheer timidity. Don't say, oh, Josephine Zion, you have no idea, sister. I can't do what God is asking me to do. I'm not qualified. Listen up now. Who told you I was qualified, huh? For doing this? I'm not qualified. You think I'm smart? I don't think so. No. God didn't call you to do what he's asking you to do because you are qualified. No. If you were qualified, he will give you something else that you are not qualified for. That's what makes it God-sized assignments, you see. God's will for our lives can only be found in God's word, the Bible. That is why it's a tragedy. If you're a believer, a genuine believer, and you don't get into the Word of God every day, really, it's a tragedy. This means God will only ask us to do what is biblically correct. God will never ask you to do something that will break the law of the country you live in, except if the country is saying you cannot worship Jesus, that you have to worship a certain religion that is against Jesus that you want to worship. Walking in God's will takes courage. Listen, I am yet to meet a man or a woman to tell me, oh, it's easy to do God's will. It's so easy. No problem. No. If you can handle it, then it's not from God. It's got to be God size. That's where your faith comes in, you see, and courage. Because it is a walk of faith all the way. The will of God forms the backbone of our calling. His word forms the backbone of our conversation. His will forms the backbone of our calling. Let's go to Acts 9:15. The book of Acts, chapter 9, verse 15. But the Lord said to Ananias, go. This man, that is Saul of Tarsus, now being converted, is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. You see, that was God's will for Saul of Tarsus, who later became Apostle Paul, not for him to be a religious fanatic, an Osama bin Laden, you see. The will that God has for your life is the will that will lift you up in life. Let's say that together. It's so beautiful. The will that God has for your life is the will that will lift you up in life. So don't go for another person's assignment. Seek God's will for your life. Moving on. God's way. That's the third W. We've talked about God's word. We've talked about God's will. And now let's talk about God's way. This is God's procedure or process showing us how God wants his plans carried out by us. Saul of Tarsus was an aristocrat, a well-educated person of noble birth. However, when he became a Christian, watch this, please. He saw all his accomplishments without Christ as vanity. He said, I counted them as dung. You see, God's way for Paul was different from the high life he used to live as a Pharisee. It was a mockety mock. You see, God's way for Apostle Paul was to preach the gospel through sufferings. So different. Paul suffered a lot from unfounded rumors and insults from others and from personal suffering of a type of body sickness or infirmity. He said, three times I beseech the Lord to take away the sickness, and the Lord said, no, my grace is enough for you, you see. And like our senior pastor, we were having a discussion some few hours back. And he said, when we suffer for Christ, it's a blessing. You see, I know that biblical truth in my heart. But I was trying to wrap my head around that, you see. He said, it's a blessing. And I was like, wow. We were talking about Apostle Paul. Why? God's way for the assignment he has for us are not always paved with roses. That's why it's with sufferings. And that's why our senior pastor was teaching us it's a blessing. Because that means you're in God's way. And you are doing it the way he wants it done. We must remember, however, that even though we are suffering, as long as we are in God, we are on God's way, God will only give his children the best. Even the suffering that is coming with it, we should believe that if it's not necessary, if it's not going to achieve a greater good for our lives, God would not have allowed it. God's utmost priority is to keep us humble, you see, lest pride cheats us of our reward in heaven. You see, God's way is the backbone of our conduct. You see, God's way will keep us humble. If I was smart enough to do what I'm doing here, but God be praised. I would have loved a different ministry, you know, where I wouldn't have to face the camera, just behind the scene, maybe praying or something. And God said, no, you see. So I have to rely on God each time I'm preparing, each time I'm coming here to teach. There's nothing to brag about, you see. That's God's way. Let's go to Psalm 126, verses 5 to 6. Psalm 126, starting from verse 5 and following. Those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy. Those who go out weeping, carrying seed to sow, will return with songs of joy, carrying sheaves with them. Are you a mother that God has given you one of his special assignments? The people of the world, they call them special needs children or children with disability. No, they are not. Those are God's special assignments. If you are blessed to have one of those children, and that's your own ministry, 24 hours, take heart. Okay? Take heart. You may cry sometimes. You may have to help that baby of yours with tears sometimes and sweat. That's okay. You know what? The Bible says, when you sow with tears, you are going to reap with joy. When we get to heaven, that's why it's really a sad case for any believer to be so caught up in this world. We ought to be looking forward to heaven, you see. When we get to heaven, there's not going to be any disability anymore. And Jesus will look at you and say, thank you for taking care of me through that child, you see. And that child won't have any disability anymore. Praise God. And that child will look at you and say, mama, thank you. Thank you for looking after me when we were down over there, you see. So it doesn't matter what you are going through. You may do it with tears, with sorrow, with sweat, but as long as it's where God has put you to be, listen, we are going to reap with joy. And Jesus is coming very soon. He's coming with his rewards for us. Amen. The old rugged path is his own blessed plan. Let me calm down and say that slowly, because you need that. God has placed that in my spirit to edify you. The old rugged path is his own blessed plan. Okay? God's way may not be paved with roses to do his assignment, but you know what? That's his plan, and it's a blessed one. Amen. Now, to live by these three W's, which we have talked about, God's word, God's will, God's way. What's going to happen to our lives if we live by those three W's? We are going to see God's work. This is God's pleasure for our lives. Hallelujah. If we live by the three W's, we will see God do what he has proposed to do in us. Apostle Paul's life became an attracting force to Christ by those watching. When they saw the magnificent work that God did in his life through the preaching of the gospel, healing of the sick, raising of the dead, even his suffering, how they were beating him up from Ephesus to Iconium to Jerusalem, and he was put in chains, handcuffed to Caesarea Philippi, and from there they shipped him off like an animal to Rome. You see, even through his suffering, people look at him and they're like, wow, you see. When we let God have his way in our lives and let him do his work through our obedience, we become, please watch this, the Holy Spirit gave me, it's so beautiful. When you let God do his work in your life through your obedience, you and I will become the specimen of his power, the testimony of his grace, the evidence of his faithfulness, and the trophy of his love. Don't you like that? The specimen of his power, the testimony of his grace, the evidence of his faithfulness, and the trophy of his love. Such that the unsaved will use our lives as an example or a yardstick of what will become of them should they give their lives to our Jesus, you see. All a pagan in your family or your workplace need to do is to see your life as Jesus has turned your life around. And they will say, okay, I think I want what you have, you see. God's work is the backbone for faith conviction. Let me say that again. God's work is the backbone for faith conviction. You want people to be convinced concerning your faith in Christ Jesus, then make sure you are living by these three W's, because God will now do what he has planned to do in your life and through your life. And all people need to see is the result of Jesus in your life. And bam, they want your Jesus. They want what you have, you see. Philippians 2:13, and I'm going to be using the New American Standard Bible. For it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. You see, when you say, oh, okay, Lord, you are asking me to do this, I will do it. That is not in your power. It's in the power of the Holy Spirit. And when you start to do it, it's not your power. It's the power of the Holy Spirit helping you to do it, so you don't have anything to brag about. So I don't have anything to strut about, you see. All the glory goes to God. God wants to announce himself through you while he annuls the self in you. Let's say that again. God wants to announce himself through you while he annuls the self in you. The less of you, the more of Jesus, the better your life becomes. The less of me, the more of Jesus in me, the better my life becomes, you see. So, what are the three W's to live by? Number one, God's word. This is God's proclamation from heaven to us through the Bible. God's will. This is God's plan concerning what he wants us to do for him. God's way. This is God's procedure or process showing how he wants us to work for him. What happens if we live according to these three W's? We see God's work. This is God's pleasure being fulfilled in and through our lives. So as a believer, that you know that the Holy Spirit is in your heart as a disciple of Jesus. Are you convinced that you are where God intends for you to be? Doing what you ought to be doing? If your answer is yes, keep going. Stay strong. Regardless of the suffering, regardless of the challenges, stay strong. Our rewards are coming soon with Jesus. Amen. If your answer is no as a believer, repent and make the necessary corrections in Jesus' name. Now, if you are an unbeliever, listen up. I've addressed you in a way during the teaching, but let me say it again. God has a plan for you. But as long as you are living your life without Jesus, guess what? You are living out the plan of the devil, the plan of Satan for your life. And God doesn't want that for you. You may have a job you enjoy right now. However, your personal life is in the wrong location of life. Because your life is controlled by circumstances around you. You see, you have a job, you're happy. You don't have a job, you're looking for a way to kill yourself. Because your life is being controlled by things happening to you. You don't need to live like that. When you anchor your life into Jesus, external circumstances won't be able to shake you. Jesus said, whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but in the light of life. The only way you can find your way in life and to eternity in heaven is through Jesus Christ. If you want to know more about that, a link is coming up. I'm going to say a quick prayer, and that link will come up. Follow that link. We'll meet you there. All right? Father, we thank you. Thank you for your word. Oh Lord, give us the grace to search the scriptures every day, to commune with you constantly. Help us to be people of the Spirit so we can receive instructions constantly from you. And for those going to want to know Jesus page, Father, help them to understand what salvation in Jesus means, O Lord. And give them the courage to commit their lives to your dear Son. In Jesus' name, amen. I'll see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.